Hey Hill City, I'm Kelly and I'm part of the team here. If this is your first time watching with us this morning, welcome to Hill City Online. We're really thankful you're watching with us and we want you to know that Hill City is a safe place for you to explore your faith. Wherever you're coming from, we want to walk with you through any doubts, fears, or questions you have about Jesus and faith. If you're new or newish, we would love to get to know you. Head on over to this link to fill out a connection card so we can put some names behind who's watching with us. In case you missed it, outdoor community group signups for the fall are open. These awesome groups are a great way to meet people and get plugged into the community here. And they start this week. Head on over to this link to sign up for one and start making some friends. Check-ins on Facebook this month go to Support No Left Turns, an organization that helps those with court and justice involvement successfully thrive post-conviction. You can read more about them at nolefturns.org. That's all for me. Next up, we've got some worship and then the second message in the Rerouting series. Thanks for being here.
You're about to move. I feel it in the wind you're about to ride in. You said that you would pour your spirit out. You said that you would fall on sons and daughters. So come.
To know your presence.
Down in the valley before love came and grabbed me. Never thought I'd see the sun again. Without a hesitation, you became my resurrection. All the light that came shining in. Now I've got beauty for ashes, and I've got joy for mourning, and I've got praise for heaviness. Love is a miracle. And I've got beauty for ashes, and I've got joy for mourning, and I've got praise for heaviness. Love is a miracle. This is more than religion. Glad I made my decision. Hope reversed the curse I was walking in. Now I'm dancing on my grave clothes. Where you lead me, I will follow. You gave a light that the darkness can't comprehend. And I've got beauty for ashes, and I've got joy for mourning, and I've got praise for heaviness. Love is a miracle. And I've got beauty for ashes, and I've got joy for mourning, and I've got praise for heaviness. Love is a miracle. I remember the voice that called me. I remember when my heart said yes. I will never forget that morning. You were singing over me like, yeah, yeah, yeah. You were singing over me like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, you were singing over. In the morning, and I've got rivers overflowing, and I've got freedom, and I'm dancing. Love is a miracle.
Well, hey, good morning, family. How are you guys? If you're new here with us, my name is John Wagler. I'm part of this Hill City team, and just so thankful that you decided to join us here today, and genuinely hope that Hill City is a place that you can call home, and if you're in the Richmond area, and even if you're not, like, this can be a place you can call home and engage with us online as well with some of our groups that we have online, our discipleship stuff, and so many other things that you can connect with here as well. And just so thankful that you're here. You know, we've been online now. We were trying to figure it out during film this week. I think this is week 24-ish of being online like this, and so it's crazy to think about that. But I did want to just have us continue to think a little bit differently about this season too, and the importance of, like, interaction within it. And so even on the comments, like, keep commenting, and as things maybe stick out to you that you really love or challenging or whatever, or if a question you have, like put that in there and share it with others. There's something beautiful about the back and forth that begins to happen in our watch parties. We're hearing a lot about people saying how beneficial it has been to have the interaction after the sermon or even like during it sometimes. And so to also do that when we're just watching together online, I think that's super important. And then of course, like share it with people. I think it's really great to be sharing this content with folks. And even today, I want to go over some things that I think will be important for people to share this information for, even if like, you know, they haven't been connected as much as we've been online, or maybe those that even decided they might want to leave because of one reason or another. I think some of the things I'm going to say today are really important for those people as well. And so just think about that as we go through the content here this morning. So this is week number 2 of our rerouting series, which is this idea about, we're lost and in so many ways. And how do we get back on track to where the focus at the end of our route is Jesus? And, we kicked it off last week with this quote that I want to highlight again by Dallas Willard, which says that the condition of our lostness is not the same as the outcome to which it leads. We're not lost because we are going to wind up in the wrong place. We are going to wind up in the wrong place because we are lost. And so that is the quote that's kind of really driving a lot of the content in this series that I think helps us, again, give us a framework of how to think about why and how we've gotten lost and this rerouting that needs to actually happen. And when we kicked it off last week, just as a little recap, we talked about the difference between the big C church and the little C church. And big C meaning all the Christians, all the denominations across the world. Little C church would be like Hill City, okay? So within the context of the big C church, there's a lot of good, actually a lot of great, a lot of things to celebrate, a lot of things to, like even like little things, maybe not so little, but like there wouldn't be hospitals without Christians. There wouldn't be a lot of schools, a lot of different things that were started by Christians. And so some of these things that been so pivotal in our culture, even our constitution and some of the things like they were based off of some Christian thoughts. And so even in that context, there's been a lot of helpful things from the big C, capital C church. There's also been some pretty atrocious things that were done. So the realities are it's pretty complicated, okay? And when we look across the church as a whole right now, there is a part of this where we seem lost. Now, there's a lot of good things that have been happening in our church and everything, but and I'll talk about some of those, but I also want to have some challenges for us too. But when we look at Christianity in general, it's complicated. And there's a lot of elements right now, in particular in the Western church and in America, church, where we've gotten lost in this. And we didn't, again, arrive at this outcome. We've been lost for quite a long time. And so we want to talk about some of those things today. Last week I said that you can't hate the church and love Jesus, okay? Because if you love Jesus, then you love his church because it's his church. Now, here's what this means about it being his church. If it's his church and it says that Jesus builds the church, and so I wrote this down, that if Jesus builds his church, then the possibilities for us are endless and the responsibility is great. All right, and so we've got to really think about then, what does it mean to be his church? And as Jesus begins to build that, what is our participation within it? The three things we highlighted last week were that we represent the kingdom of heaven, right? Like that's what for us, it's like, okay, who are we? Well, we represent the kingdom of heaven as a church. The second thing that we talked about was that when people encounter the church, they should think to themselves, oh, this must be what God is like. Okay, that's a big deal. And then the third thing that we actually talked about as well is that even if someone theologically disagrees, they're enamored with the way that we live because it's like, man, that is so good for others. Okay, so that's the premise of what we're going to build on off of today. And originally I was going to do something different for this week, but I really felt just compelled just by the Spirit of God. Like as I was studying scripture and writing down notes, I felt compelled to add a part 2 to this week, and because I started thinking about 2020, and at the start of this, it was like I feel like every church that I knew was doing a series like, 2020, like 2020 Insight or something around 2020 Vision or something like that. And everyone was so excited for this new beginning, this new decade. And then it just went off the rails so quick. And, you know, the virus comes in and, you know, a lot of things have been exposed in us through the virus. You know, we even make that political. I don't care which side you or how you think about the virus. We just made it political, which is silly to me because it's like it's about people and people's health and different things like that. We see how selfish we can be in the midst of all that. You know, you got people losing jobs. You've got weird weather things. Like, it's been crazy, like some of that stuff. We've got, and honestly, in all my years of ministry now, in 18 years of ministry, this is by far the year with the most pain and suffering and death and depression and just like really big things happening in people's lives. I've never seen it like this in my lifetime in ministry. You know, we've got fires going on. We had the racial unrest. You got people shooting police officers now. You got chaos like everywhere. There's just so many things that have been happening in this year. And in the midst of it, what we've begun to see is that the voice of the church is actually lost. Are there pockets where it's good? Absolutely, absolutely. But as a whole, the voice of the church is lost right now. And again, we didn't just arrive here just now. It's been lost because as a whole, we see that the church is actually lost. You know, we started off this year in 2020 with, which is a God-ordained series. It was called Exiles. And in week two of that series, I was talking about all about resilience over those weeks to start off. And in week two, I said this, I said, the person we are before a crisis or challenge will be the person we are when we are in it. Okay, now, I did not know 2020 was gonna be happening the way that it was gonna happen. I didn't know all of this stuff, but I will say this, that line really has held true. That line has proved itself to be true because, man, we have seen a lot about people. We've seen a lot about church. We've seen a lot about Christianity in the midst of all this. So if you're just hopping into Christianity, if you're just hopping into faith, if you're questioning, if you're just hopping into our church and trying to see what we're about, this is a really great week to be here because I want to highlight some things that I think are critical for our church. There has been so much good, y'all, like so much good. I was just, you know, thinking about our birthday celebration last week when we had an unreal like time at Celebration Church with our worship night and baptisms and communion and man, the buzz that was there last weekend. It is hard for me, like I was in tears most of the night. It's hard for me to even like describe or put into words what it was like to be back together. And I kept hearing people say something to this effect, my soul needed that, right? And so there's just so much beauty, so many good things going on in our church and so much to celebrate and so much to be encouraged by. And I wanna highlight that part a lot. But there's this also, when I think about not only my role as the leader of this church, Lacey and I co-leading this church, and when we talk and when we think about our roles here and what it means to shepherd our community, you know, we don't ever put ourselves above anybody else. I say I'm part of this team because that's what I am. I'm part of this team. And but there is also a reality that we shepherd this church, and there are responsibilities that go along with that of protection and making people aware of things that are happening. And there are specific a specific weight that is put on our shoulders that really others do not share in our community. And that's okay. Like we signed up for this. So I'm not remotely complaining. It's just a reality. Even in James, it talks about that, like I will be held more accountable than like, if you're just listening to this, I am held more accountable than you are around this content and everything. So the seriousness of all of this and what that means and how, that's why it's so much prayer and study goes into every single sermon. That's why when we think about what we're doing in our vision, like there's so much prayer that goes into this and so much we're trying to make sure we're trying to handle it the way God wants us to handle it. And I'm not saying we're perfect by any stretch, and I'll get into some of that, but there is a reality. And so when I'm looking at our church right now, there are some things, all the great things I'm all in on, and we celebrate those things all the time. But I also am seeing some things that I want to protect us from because there's some little things rising up right now. And it reminds me of like this idea of like, like someone who might be running a sprint, but it's really a marathon, or you're just running the wrong race and you're on the wrong route. And imagine going on a marathon and you take the wrong turn and you're like, man, I am way off base here. I'm lost, right? You're on the wrong path. And I see little things and I'm gonna fight like crazy for our culture. Lacey, I will fight like crazy for us concentrating on the right things, on the right parts of the gospel, on the right parts of scripture, and push on these things. And I'm not going to settle for anything less than that. And so we're gonna continue to revisit this. I don't ever wanna get in a place where we look back and be like, man, we saw that coming and we weren't aggressive enough in addressing it. And so listen, there might be some things that make you mad today. I hope not, but I'm just hoping it's conviction for all of us. But I hope that we will take a breath and take all of this in, because I think, I really believe God has placed this on my heart. And I want to start with this in Galatians 5 verses 7 through 9, which says this: you were running a good race. This is Paul talking to the church in Galatia. He says, you were running a good race. Like, who cut in on you to keep you from obeying the truth? That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough. And so I want to talk about the little yeast today. And because what he's saying is, man, you get a little yeast in there, man, how quickly it spreads. And so I want to address some things that I'm seeing that taps into culture as well, but that's actually impacting our own church. And so here are a couple of things. I'm going to go through three things in particular this morning. And here's the first thing. For us as a church, here's the first reminder. We need to be present, but not perfect. We need to be present, but not perfect. Acts 20, verses 22 to 24, Luke is describing, he wrote this letter of Acts, and Paul is kind of the main character in Acts. Well, I should say the church as a whole is the main character. Paul is one of the main characters in his story. And he says this in there, and I was really like taken back reading this week. He says, and now I am compelled by the Spirit. And honestly, this is what I felt this week prepping this message. So I've been compelled by the Spirit. I'm going into Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task that the Lord Jesus has given me. The task of testifying to the good news, right? That's the gospel that we always talk about, the good news of God's grace. I almost highlighted that whole entire passage, but we want to be present, but not perfect. We want to recognize we're not perfect, but we want to be present. And so I started thinking about this. Like Paul is saying, like, listen, the Spirit's just, he's telling me, go to Jerusalem. And Jerusalem, here's what's coming. In every city that you're going to go to, Paul, you're going to face hardships and suffering and pain and beatings, imprisonment and death at some point. And he's like, you know what? But I still have to be present. I still have to go. I still have to be around. And so I started thinking about this. Okay, what is like a good reminder for us in thinking through what Paul's saying there? And the first one is this, that I want you guys to write down if you're taking notes, when you should be taking notes, is this, that we need to show up, and then we need to be consistent, all right? We need to show up, and we need to be consistent. We need to show up for people when it's hard. We need to show up for people when they're celebrating. We need to show up when people are suffering. We need to show up at funerals. We need to show up when babies are born. We need to show up with meals. We need to show up with money. We need to show up with a hug. We need to show up just to listen. We need to show up, and we need to be consistent about it. You guys that have been watching online, a lot of you are very, very consistent. So right now, I'm like preaching to the choir a little bit. Some of you guys in the watch party has been very consistent, been preaching to the choir, discipleship, preaching to the choir right now. And I understand that. But you know what? You probably know someone who has not been showing up. You probably know someone who has not been consistent. You probably know some folks who maybe have been like in and out of this whole online thing, and they've lost connection to the church, and they're kind of like, oh, I'm just gonna wait till we start gathering in person again and that whole bit. But we need to show up and be consistent. And sometimes it's hard. And sometimes it's annoying. And sometimes you sacrifice your schedule. And sometimes it's not what you want. And sometimes you gotta be online when you'd rather be in person. But you know what? Get over it. show up and be consistent. That has got to be within the core of who we are. Why? Because listen, this is not about us. This is about God's grace. This is about the message of the gospel that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he died and rose again so that we can have life and live that out and build this kingdom here on this earth. Like, that's what we're doing. So that is our focus. That is our route. That is the race that we are running that we should be compelled to do. I get it. We'd all rather be gathering together. I get it. Like, I will be the first in line. Like, that's why, again, when I walked in, the band was practicing last Sunday night, and I just immediately filled up with tears because I just felt, I'm like, oh my gosh, my soul has been yearning for this and just seeing people and all this stuff. Like, it was crazy last week, okay? So I get it. But let's not be complainers. Let's not, you know, just start like throwing this away. Like God is doing stuff in the midst of all of this. Why? Because he wants to see who's going to continue to show up. He wants to see who's going to continue to be consistent. He wants to see how we're going to keep pushing in on what God has for us. You see, consistency is actually what allows us to handle a crisis. Consistency will allow us to grow. Consistency allows us to bring the best habits. All right, so we've got to be consistent. The second thing I want us to do out of this is we want to give grace. All right, Paul says at the end of this is what I'm testifying to give grace, to God's grace. You see, when we appreciate God's grace, we want to give it to other people. When we see God's grace, like, we really want to say, oh, okay, like I've received God's grace. I want to give this to other people too. And it doesn't mean we don't have, you know, boundaries and all that stuff. We're not doormats and all that, but like, we are gracious people in particular to each other. And so when I started kind of thinking through this part of the passage, I just want to highlight this. We are not a monolithic church, okay? We don't all think the same. We aren't going to vote the same, you know, come November. We have different perspectives on things. Like, one of the main lines in our church is we want diversity in thought, not division in community. And that is hard. It's like unbelievably hard. And because it would be so much easier to just sit there and just keep like kind of like the itching ears and be like, oh, we've got a bunch of liberal people, we got a bunch of conservative people, we got whatever, and to just kind of just like speak to the echo chamber. That's easy. Anybody can do that. But to really be gracious to one another and begin to serve one another and sacrifice for one another and understand we might think differently about certain things, but man, to love one another and be gracious to one another in the midst of this is hard. And I get that, okay? But that's what we're fighting for. Listen, I don't say everything perfectly. I don't. Like, there's something, like, literally every single Sunday, if you were to talk to me when we were meeting three times on a Sunday, if you talked to me after every single Sunday, I would be like, you know what? I didn't say that part right. I didn't say that part right. I wish I would have said this. Like, it happens all the time, okay? I pray all the time, but God, anything that I might have said that wasn't right, will you just zap that from someone's brain? And I get that. Sometimes, whether it's on our podcast or even, you know, in your discipleship groups, your coach or Lacey or any of our other leaders, like, we don't always say things the right way or articulate the exact right way that we may have, but give grace and ask questions. We need to do that to each other. Like, Jesus tells us to do that. Even when he says, hey, if there's something going on, like, go and meet and ask people, okay? It's just fascinating to me. I was thinking about this part. Some of the worst things people have ever said about me, some of the most slanderous things people have ever said about me, whether it's through email or anonymous letters or whatever, sometimes even in person, but some of the worst things have been by Christians. Like, and that's sad to me. The lack of grace that's happened in the midst of that, like, it's sad. Like, people like literally label me a certain way or make things up about me based off maybe one line that I say or something like that, and will form a whole opinion of me and will talk about it and gossip about it and slander and like try and group people together. Now, has that happened a lot in our church? It hasn't. Like, again, we are in a good spot. I'm just saying this is like just one of the things they're just being careful about and understanding. There's some folks that have been like so good with this. There was a meeting I had in the lobby with one guy. This is a few months ago now, and we didn't agree. Like, I kind of stuck to what I was saying and he was sticking to what he was saying, but it was such a beautiful conversation because he said this to me. He said, you know, I didn't agree with what you said in that sermon on that little angle of perspective you were taking, but I trusted your heart. And it was like this amazing conversation. And, you know, we didn't ultimately agree, but I did believe this, like he saw where I was coming from and I saw where he was coming from and we appreciated and valued it. Another guy named Seth, we'll call him Seth. I can't remember which series it was, but I was talking about empire and the kingdom of God and the difference and how we're supposed to think about it. And he works in government. And he said, what you've said, I agree with theologically about there should be the separation. And if we are Christians, we should be way more like Daniel and everything else within the context of the kingdom of God and learning how to separate the empire and the kingdom of God and what the Bible actually says about it. And he goes, and I agree with you. And he goes, but you know, as someone who works in government, you didn't like give me enough encouragement, nor did you actually like say like maybe how to like handle it. And it was like so good because then it allowed me the next week to then present it a little fuller picture because he understood where I was coming from. I understood where he was coming from. And it was really, really great. And it's been so helpful to have those conversations. And so for us, I just want to remind us, like, we're not going to be people that are going to hide or gossip or slander. We're going to be people that ask questions. The early church dealt with all this stuff too. As they were kind of engaging what it meant to preach the gospel and declare Jesus as Lord and all those other things, they were placed in a really interesting spot. The religious elite, the fundamentalist, legalistic religious people wanted to imprison and kill them. The Roman government wanted to imprison and kill them. The secular pagan people wanted to actually imprison and kill them. And in the end, what happened, they just kept preaching Jesus as Lord. They just kept serving and being generous. They just kept building a community based on grace, based on love, based on justice, based on shared experience. And here's what ended up happening. We see this in Acts chapter 2. It says that God continued to add to their numbers. And then the people that were once so angry and so mad and everything, they were just so enamored by the way that these Christians lived their lives that they then would come back around and be like, you know what? Tell me about this Jesus thing. And that leads me to my second point, which is this. We need to be about camping, not glamping. Camping, not glamping. Now, hear me out. Here's a little picture of glamping. I would do that. All right. I'm all about a little glamping. I am not about camping. Listen, that's just the way it is. All right. I will glamp it up. And people who know that have ever traveled with me, they love it when I make the plans. All right. Because they know it's going to be a little bougie. that's just me. All right. I admit it. But here's the thing about camping. See, glamping is about comfort. Okay. And all that. But camping, here's what you need. You need discipline. You need to prepare. You need to get all in it. You need to battle elements, right? You need hard work, and it's raw. It's all those things, right? And so when we think about Christianity, we need to be about camping and not glamping because we can't be just consumed by our comfort. There's nothing to brag about in glamping, right? Like other than like the space that you're in, like that picture I showed would be wonderful, but you're bragging about the space, right? But you're not bragging about anything you've done. You know, there's nothing to like celebrate in that instance, but the only thing you can celebrate is comfort because here's what glamping doesn't do. It doesn't prepare you for the wild. Like, so if we're about comfort as Christians, we are not prepared for this crisis. We are not prepared for 2020. Listen, the hardest part of 2020 has not happened yet. With what's in the most divisive, hateful part of our year is about to happen in a month. And so, we haven't even gotten to that point yet. And so it's like, we can't be about comfort. We can't be about glamping. We've got to be about camping. Jeremiah 12:5 actually says this. If you have raced with men on foot and they have worn you out, how can you compete with horses? If you stumble in safe country, how will you manage in the thickets by the Jordan? And God, this is God speaking to the prophet Jeremiah. And he's like, listen, you've had it easy. Like little persecution, things have been like kind of handed to you. You've been able to kind of go in and out of stuff. And it's like, you can't even handle this. Like you're a mess right now. You're lost right now. And you think you're going to handle when it's hard? No way. God's like, you got to think about this very differently. And he's calling his people to something else. And that is what I believe we are in right now. It's been easy to be a Christian in our country. It's been easy to even call yourself a Christian, even when they do these statistics. And I'll go through some of this stuff in the Jesus for President series. But even when they go through the statistics and say 81% of white evangelicals voted for Donald Trump, I can rip those statistics apart in a heartbeat. And so, but why? Because part of it is like, people, you can just claim you're a Christian. Like, it's so easy. But what happens when you got to run with the horses? What happens when you got to go through the thickets by the Jordan? What are you really left with? What race are you able to handle? You know, this was a while ago. I had a dream. This is when we were doing the Sermon on the Mount series. I had a dream in the midst of that series that I felt like God was speaking to me in the dream. And I'm standing before God, and people are coming up to heaven, okay? And they're coming up for the day of judgment. And people from Hill City are coming up. And they're just like wearing like Hill City shirts. And that's how I knew that they were part of our community. And every time he said, I don't even know you. And like the Hill City person was pushed off to the side, he would then look over at me and say, where were you on that? And so when I talk about the weight that sometimes and that we shoulder, that's part of it. And I remember just kind of springing up out of bed and being like, and breathing, my heart's racing and everything. And actually, that's what birthed our discipleship that we're doing right now. And then Lacey and her team like took that idea and made it literally a zillion times better than I could have ever remotely made it. And like the stuff that they're doing now is, it is top shelf stuff, y'all. And it's gonna keep getting better. But it was birthed out of this idea of like, man, are we helping prep people? And are people taking this serious enough? The second thing that I just want to highlight with that is like, we don't want to be people that just blend in. I don't want to lead a community that just wants to blend in. That's easy. That is easy to do. But we've got to push on the right things. Listen, even Jesus, like in Revelations 3, 14 through 16, Jesus is speaking and he talks about being lukewarm. And he says, I'm going to spit lukewarm people out. You know what lukewarm is? Blending in. Lukewarm is this idea, and actually the word is actually, it's actually puking or vomiting. That the idea of someone who would claim that they are a follower of Jesus to be someone who would blend in or be lukewarm, that Jesus says, I want to vomit that out. Like that's how he feels about it. And so I don't want us to blend in. But in order for us not to blend in, we're going to have to push in on things. One of the questions I wrote this week was like, am I more concerned with comfort or what it means to follow Jesus? Am I more concerned with comfort or what it means to follow Jesus? And so so we're going to continue to push in on hard things. We're going to continue to talk about hard things. We're going to continue to challenge each other on everything. We're going to continue to attack the idols that we see in our country. And listen, the idols are all based off always, they're always based off the same things. Politics, power, greed, money, and sex. Those are always the idols. Like all of the idols boil down to that. And so we're going to continue to not only push in on them, but challenge each other on it. And yep, sometimes we're going to get offended. You guys, so many of my sermons, like I'm offended. Like when I'm talking my notes and I'm saying them, like I'm offended in my soul because I know what this means that might need to change. And so I want to challenge us to be sensitive towards those times where we say, yeah, but what about? So when something's brought up, whether it's in your discipleship group or in your community group or like in a sermon or on a podcast or whatever, like be very, very careful with your, yeah, what about? Sure, I hear that, but what about, that's called whataboutisms, right? Like why does it happen? So when you feel yourself saying that, like ask yourself, why did I just say that? Why am I thinking that? What does that reveal in me that the first thing I want to say is, yeah, but what about? Because a lot of times when we start critiquing certain things that we see in culture, in terms of Christian culture, and how it's tied into like the world's culture, we get offended really, really, really easily. We take a step back and we're like, how dare you say that, you know, whatever. And I've seen this like even recently. I'll give you a couple examples this is in no way, this is just like two examples that happened to me recently. I was talking about the rioting and the looting and the violence and some of the things that even some of the organizers have been saying in social media and stuff like that. And I was saying, hey, you know, we can see in some of this stuff that there's been some good in the protesting, obviously, and some of the reasons behind it. But there's also been some unbelievable evil and also some injustice have been like they've caused and stuff like that in the midst of it. And so I was talking to someone and I said, you know, when you when you think about God being removed from a lot of that, you see the chaos that ends up happening. You see the lack of love. You see the lack of one another's. You see those lack of things. And Christians are like blended in some of that. They're not set apart from it like they should be. And the person responded, yeah, I mean, I understand that, but what about, and I was like, well, why did you just ignore like the love one another part, the things that Jesus taught, to be set apart from evil and some of those things? And I was like, well, there's a bigger picture. I'm like, no, the big picture is Jesus. And what do we see in that conversation? Well, there's some lust, like there's got lost somewhere in the midst of all these things. Same thing happened like recently. I caught a little bit of flack, which is okay, from something I posted where I was saying that a politician at one point had just, he took out Jesus. I'm actually going to reference the passage here in the next point. Took out Jesus and replaced it with a term for America. And I said, I don't understand. I don't even care like who you vote for. I really don't. But I don't understand if you're a Christian, how you can't be screaming at that. Like literally just like, ah! Like how could anyone ever do that? Like as a Christian, like we can't, we just can't do stuff like that. And I get it. Like people are doing that all over the place. But like to see it so blatant, I was like, man, like the Bible is like, and like God is like very specific about when people do stuff like that. He's very specific throughout the entire Bible and all these writers, like when people do things like that. And like, it's not good. His response to that stuff is not good. And so, but I don't understand like why we can't pause for a second and be like, again, you could still vote for that grouping of people. I'm not even saying not to do that. It's just like, how are we not as Christians set apart there and being like, no, that is not okay, right? What is that showing? Something's gotten twisted. So we got to push in on these things. Is it going to be challenging? Of course, but we've got to do it. So we will not stop preaching the power of the gospel, that Jesus is Lord. He died and rose again so we could have life and build his kingdom here on this earth. This does not mean I'm anti-America. This does not mean I'm anti-military. This does not mean I'm anti-police or we are anti-anything. It does not mean we are socialists. It does not mean we are liberal. It does not mean we're conservative. It does not mean we are Republican. It does not mean we're pro-Trump or anti-Trump or pro-Biden or anti-Biden. It does not mean any of those things. It does not mean I'm judging you if you voted a certain way. It does not mean I'm belittling anyone if they think a certain way differently. But what it is like we're trying to be pro-Jesus and pro-Scripture and push us towards that. And we want to be defined by what Scripture says. We want to be defined in terms of like how we process everything through Scripture, and stop with the whatabouts and stop with the picking a political side. We want to flow everything through what Scripture says, and the Spirit of God is moving us towards. Our views and responses need to point to the text of what Jesus taught rather than the subtext of culture. We will not stop pushing towards unity. I'm all for that. But we can't have unity with each other until we appreciate each other and value each other and challenge each other and point things out in each other, until we wrestle with hard topics with each other. We've got to talk about it, but we've got to do it with respect and with grace. And some of you guys do a wonderful job with that, truly wonderful. But I'm, again, seeing little pockets of things that are unhealthy that could lead to being completely lost. We will not stop pushing around items of sex and sexuality and identity and all those things, like to what God desires for us around that topic. We will not stop pushing on the issue of justice, whether that's the poor or the marginalized or issues of race or abortion, care for refugees, acts of violence of any kind, all done through the lens of Scripture, not a political talking point. We will not stop doing that. We will not stop pushing each other about money. Like, we're going to talk about money and generosity. A big heart for people will redefine how we think about our money. And we're going to keep pushing on that. Our share offerings coming up, I get it, it's different this year because with job markets and different things like that. And we understand all of that. But our share offering that we do every year to help organizations and help people, it's coming up. It's going to come up in November again, where we just talk about how we give this money, we bring it all together in this one big offering, we give it all away. And so like we're approaching giving away $1 million as a community by the end of this year, which is fantastic, but we're gonna keep pushing, because a church shines when things get darkest, and generosity is something that is like reveals a light that is coming through people. So we're going to push on that. And we're gonna keep saying like, hey, we gotta be involved, we gotta give, we gotta be generous, and we're gonna keep helping people. Like, we've got a lot of needs, and listen, if you're not involved, like, you gotta get involved, you gotta be consistent, you gotta have that apart, everything. That's gotta be who we are as a community. We'll not stop pushing towards community. You know, we've got discipleship groups, we've got community groups, we've got watch parties, and we want to increase all of those, get involved and attached to those. We need community, we need to be connected. We're going to gather again, you guys. We got we've got September 27th worship night coming up next Sunday. October 11th, we're going to meet here indoors back to like a normal Sunday, okay? October 11th, November 8th, and December 6th, we're going to be meeting here indoors. It's kind of like meeting in the middle with all of this. We're going to meet, take a few weeks off, meet, take a few weeks off. We're going to enter into all of this slowly, and then we'll be back around for Christmas Eve services as well. And we're going to keep pushing us towards that. Keep pushing towards the community with our organizations that we partner with, and serving with them and joining in them with our kids team. Like, y'all, like, the kids team and whether that's with our elementary school kids or middle school or high school, like, they are just putting in hours after hours after hours and content and content and content and giving ways to like be helpful to all you parents. And like, we're just gonna keep pushing all of those things and as a way to continue to connect and have fun together and all of that stuff. It's not about our comfort. It's about really getting in on all of this. That's who we have to be, or else we're gonna run the wrong race. Is it harder? Yes, it's harder. Will we sometimes get mad at each other? Yes, that happens. But man, we've got to be a different kind of community. Number three, we need to be resilient, not rigid. Resilient or not rigid. When I was thinking about this, I thought of this picture here from The Incredibles, with a mom from The Incredibles, right? Like, she's unbelievably resilient. Why? Because she's unbelievably flexible. And I just thought about this. Here is 2020. In this picture, okay? So when we think about resilience, this is the idea of being flexible, by kind of being adaptable and understanding, I can take it, but I can kind of come back to strength. I can do these things. And being rigid means being legalistic. Being rigid means being fragile. The reason why no rules, like, you know, what we saw, like, even when we saw, like, the community that tried to be started in Seattle that lasted, like, 2 weeks before, like, all hell broke loose with that thing. The reason why it doesn't work, like, no rules and every person for themselves and all that stuff, it doesn't work because it's rigid. It doesn't work because it needs a foundation, and it needs a strong foundation to build off of, and you need order. Chaos doesn't work. The reason why legalism doesn't work, right? Like you can see this even fundamentally in Christianity sometimes, and where people are like, you're in, you're out, you're like that stuff. The reason why that doesn't work, because it's fragile. Because you realize, I don't control as much as I think I can. Or you realize that everyone's kind of broken. You realize everyone makes mistakes. You realize all of a sudden you're like, I didn't think that would happen to me. Now I wish there was grace instead of those rules, right? And so you start seeing that. So that's why it's rigid. Legalism is rigid, and it doesn't work, and it breaks so easily. But we need to be the kind of community that is resilient. If you want to hear more about resilience, you can go back to the series in on Exiles, where I talked about that for 7 weeks around resilience. But I want to go through this passage in Hebrews 12, which says this, and this is it. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great clouds of witnesses. Now, what he's saying there is, like, all the people that have ever been around and have died and everything else, like a great cloud of witnesses. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles us. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on who? Jesus, okay? The pioneer and perfecter of the faith. So here's why I got so mad that with what happened when the person put in, instead of Jesus, that he took Jesus out in that passage right there and put in Old Glory. But when that happened, I was like, no! No, that is like one of the worst things you can do, right? Why? Because it sends us on a race that isn't about Jesus. It sends us on a race that's not about him. And so it's the pioneer and the perfecter of the faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So when we think about this part, here's what I want our community to be. We've got to take hits. We've got to understand what's happening around us. We need to adapt and be flexible to the things that we see to reach people. Listen, if the best thing for us to do was to meet outside for the remainder of the year, for the next 2 years, because that was going to be the best way to reach people, and sometimes it'd be hot, sometimes it'd be freezing cold, sometimes it'd be uncomfortable, sometimes our kids would be running all around, but that was the best way to reach people, then we need to do it. If the best thing for us to do is to not gather at all indoors, and this is like ends up being the best thing, and we just do a bunch, we do hundreds of watch parties across the city and neighborhoods, then we do it. We stay flexible. We stay adaptable. We take the hits. We're resilient. We stretch out, right? Show the strength and come back with that strong foundation. Why? Because of the gospel of Christ. So here's what I want us to be and the kind of attitude that I want us to have. And listen, I know I went long today, but I had a lot on my mind. We need to be the kind of community that has a bring it kind of attitude. All right, so when it gets tough, and we talk about tough topics, we say, bring it, let's talk about it, let's wrestle it, let's go through scripture, let's be in this together. When we talk about tough things in culture that we're battling, bring it on, let's wrestle with these things, let's dive in, let's keep Jesus at the center and keep doing that. When it comes about tough times like this year, bring it. Why? Because we know we're the kind of community that can rally, that can fight, that will not shrink back from these times. That is what who we're supposed to be. That can only happen, though, when our route is the one that's pointing towards Jesus and our eyes are fixed on that. People around us are lost, and we need to be the kind of church that steps in and says, let me represent who the answer is so that you can be found. Let me show you who the answer is. Let's be the kind of community. I don't know, would your community welcome me in? Oh, you can come in our community. Yeah, but I kind of think you can come in our community and we'll wrestle with this together. And that's what we do. We bring that part on. We're like, we're all in on that. That's who we are, okay? Now, is it always gonna be hard topics that we talk about? Of course not. There'll be different things that can kind of get plugged in the midst of all of that. We've got a lot of things planned that aren't gonna just be like kind of always pounding the fist. But I do think there's a reality where we are right now. And so, for all of us, I just don't want us to be distracted, but I do want us to be challenged. And I want us to make sure that there's nothing cutting in on us and getting us to run the wrong kind of race. And so, let me just pray for us. God, this morning, I hope every single person listening to this will pause for a second. We'll begin to really reflect on maybe some things that have started to cut in. None of us are above that. None of us are perfect. None of us don't make mistakes. None of us, you know, are free from saying things the wrong way. None of us are, like, we've all been impacted by things that we shouldn't be impacted by or influenced by things we should be influenced by. And so, but we all have to humbly come open-handed, open hearts, and open minds to come to you. And that's the kind of community we want. Why? Because, God, that's the kind of community you taught us to have. Jesus, in all of his teachings and what he was kind of pushing people towards, that's what he taught. Paul and Peter and James and the writers of the New Testament, pushing that and pushing that and pushing that kind of thinking. And so, God, my prayer is, honestly, that's who we would be. That would be our foundation. And through that, people who don't know you, who have never chosen to follow you, would be like, oh, that is what I want. That's what I want to see. That's what I want to be a part of. Because we see how amazing it is to follow you. We give this to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you guys so much for sticking with me today and being a part of everything. If you've got any questions or anything, you can go to that link tree or our website to get connected to people and they'll answer your questions. Or if you need prayer, whatever it is, there are ways to go do that on that link tree that you see there. Again, thank you guys so much. You talked about it, again, the last couple of weeks around generosity and just being involved. We do have that share offering coming up in November, so we just want to put that in front of you for those that don't know. What we typically ask us for people to just give 1 day's wage, and we collect all that money, and we'll give you what that could be, but we collect all that money and we give it away to a bunch of organizations throughout Richmond and to people, individuals who like really need help. And you know, we typically are giving $150,000 to $200,000 away through all of that. And when it's all said and done, over the years, we've done a few $100,000, I should say. And so it's a really incredible time for us to be generous together. But we've also got to be consistent doing that outside of just that offering. And so, because we're always like helping people, that we talk about that every week. And thank you guys so much for being a part of that. I love you guys. Thank you for being a part of this community and making it great. I do believe God's got incredible things planned for us. And I'm excited to see what that is. We'll see you guys next week.
Thanks so much for being a part of this morning. If you're out there and have questions, prayer needs, or want to talk to someone about next steps in your faith, then head on over to that same link from before and fill out a connection card. We'll see you next week.